Capital Weekly's Politics on Tap is co-produced by Capital Weekly, the newspaper of California government and politics, and the California Channel, providing California with 20 years of public affairs broadcasting. Funding for Capital Weekly's Politics on Tap is made possible by the generous support of the California cable and telecommunications industry.
Hey, thanks for joining us on Politics on Tap. We always have a good time here talking, but it's always better when you're sitting here with us. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Kimberly Nalder, the director of the Project for an Informed Electorate. Is that?
That's right.
Okay.
It's in the future.
Okay. Thank you. At California State University, Sacramento. On my left is John Howard. He's the editor of Capital Weekly, the sponsor of our show, longtime Associated Press reporter, bureau chief for the Orange County Register. Not sure where to start off, so I was going to ask you, Doc, what have you been doing since we saw you here last?
I've been working on
informing the electorate.
You know, I've been informing the electorate. You've noticed they're informed now, right? I've been working on, actually this week, writing up a report for a survey we did with the Center for California Studies on how people perceive their local government and what they want out of it and what they know about it, which has been kind of interesting. Do you want more details on that?
Oh, totally. I mean, wouldn't you think that you'd feel a greater connection to your local government than, like, the further you get away from yourself, the less you trust them? I don't know.
It's based on
my sister's perception of stuff. But
your sister's right on. Yeah, that's what you find is that people trust the local governments more and the state a little bit more than the feds, and, you know, sort of goes that way. But they don't know any more about what the local government is doing than what the federal government is doing. And in fact, it's the other way around.
I think people like the locals, and I think elected officials, state elected officials, like to be local, depending on the local government. But
right.
I just saw a story the other day that more and more elected officials at the state level, after they get termed out, they go to a local level. They go to the Orange County Board of Supervisors or the LA Council, LA Board. There's more exposure, more power. It's just another chance to keep the election juices flowing. So it doesn't surprise me at all that the locals are getting more and more attention.
And it must feel good too, right, to go back to the local where
sure.
You'll have higher approval ratings and be less reviled.
Yeah.
Right. that must be nice.
Okay, I guess the part I don't get is how come they don't know what their local officials do? Because I would think if you're building a mother-in-law thing on top of the garage.
Right.
I mean, you have to go down there and get the building permit from whoever it happens to be. Or
right. So there's more, you would think, more kind of day-to-day contact.
Nobody picked up the trash.
Right. So that's
the
local. But ask people, okay, nobody picked up the trash. Who's your local council member on the city council who you might call about that? They don't know. I mean, any more than they know the state level either. But, you know, even though...
That's odd. So they know whose responsibility is, but they don't know how to...
They don't know who's... I mean, they know it's the city, maybe.
Right.
We did this... One of the questions we had on there that I kind of love-hate is we asked people, which does your city spend the most money on? And one of the options was public safety, which was the right answer. And then we had a federal responsibility and a state responsibility. We had food stamps, Medi-Cal, and aid to California, other California cities, which we totally pulled out of nowhere. Yeah, those are the options you could pick, right?
Yeah.
So we made these things up, right? Well, the aid to local cities, which doesn't exist, right? To other cities in California. And only 25% got it right. And, you know, a good chunk of the people fell for the things that were responsibilities of other levels of government. And that's because we don't know. You know, as a regular citizen who has a job and, you know, family and other, you know, interests, you don't pay attention necessarily to who does what. And people who are sort of political insiders think that they do more than is the reality.
You mean think people do or think themselves
do? We think that people know more about local government or what the different levels of government are responsible for, I think, than people do. They just sort of want things to work right.
It's a common mistake I make. I assume more knowledge in a reader than they probably
sure.
actually
right.
have.
It
or
was
care
for
to
many years. Sacramento sort of fell into a crack in news coverage. The papers knew their local elected officials. They covered the school district in depth.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew the federal government. And there were people in Washington, they followed federal policy and federal politics, and there was a lot of visibility, but state government, except for the governor, and maybe the attorney general sometimes, but the 120 legislators up here, except in their own districts, really sort of went into obscurity, kind of like our congressional delegation does now. Once they get elected to Congress, we don't see a lot of coverage of them here. I'm not sure why that is, but they kind of go into a black hole.
I think they'd be grateful on some level. Yeah, right. I mean, if you're embarrassing yourself, it's better to do so in obscurity, right?
3,000 miles away, right. Of course, yeah.
Well, and the way our media is set up, you know, you've got local TV news, for example, that serves a whole region. If they're covering state legislators, they have a good number of state legislators they would need to cover in order to report well, and they don't tend to do that.
Well, I get a kick out of the local news on election night, right, where they'll start running, and in the El Dorado County City Council race, and it's like, that's the first time you've said those words in the entire year, and probably the only time you'll say it, mm-hmm. right? And so it's like, okay, well, how could we possibly care?
Right.
If you've never told us about it
exactly.
before.
Their name has never come up on the newscast.
Right. Yeah.
Every ballot I pick up, and I follow this stuff, and every time I go to a precinct to vote, because I don't do it by mail, I like to go into into the ballot box and see what's going on. There are judges I've never heard of. There are commission members.
Don't you vote for the ones like that have the weirdest name? That's what I do.
That's a better idea than what I do, which
like
is I try
to
vote for
the
incumbent.
Like if there's a guy with all consonants and no vowels, it's like, man, yeah. I hope you're the Chief Justice, baby.
There are never any ads for him unless they've had a controversial case, like they reversed something that caused a local furor or something. But the whole judiciary is almost uncovered in California, as far as I can tell. Except at the Supreme Court, state Supreme Court level, and the appellate courts. I mean, they get a lot of coverage, but there are so few people, so few judges that I have ever heard of when I go into go to vote, and there's 6, 7, 8 of them on the ballot. It's just kind of amazing. They're powerful, important people.
Central committee members.
Yeah.
I think communism when I see that, but.
Right. But just the idea that we should vote on judges in the first place is problematic. I mean, for lots of reasons, but one of them being that there's no way we're making informed decisions about it.
Okay, I would agree with you on the second part of that. On the first part, I think it's
better.
Well, the Supreme Court judges have 12-year terms, unless somebody resigns and then you fill out the remainder of their term.
Yeah.
And I think that's marginally better than federal judges who are appointed for life. And make decisions, at least in my observation, with the full knowledge that nobody can do anything to them.
Yeah, I mean, I think it might make sense to maybe have an age limit or something like that. But the idea that they're responding to the will of the electorate at the time runs counter to the concept of what the judiciary is supposed to be doing, right? They're interpreting the Constitution and they're above the sort of political fray. And I get concerned when people want to throw out a judge because we didn't like a decision.
Yeah, they're not tough on crime.
Right.
And it's one instance. Right.
Right.
Well, it's funny, you reminded me of watching the Zimmerman verdict, and they had a guy on TV, and I've forgotten what channel. And he says, the jury they didn't show any compassion at all. And it's like, they're not supposed to. Like, the judge gives them a very extensive instruction, like,
right.
We don't do compassion here. We do, are they guilty beyond a reasonable doubt,
right.
I mean, you can say that this guy was out with a gun on, which is perfectly legal in Florida, and looking for trouble, right, and found it. But, it's not murder one. But I was just, you're mentioning this thing about how people don't quite get, what different levels of government do. It's like, that's so not what juries do.
Right.
They're not supposed to do that. And yet, they didn't show any compassion. I don't know.
Well, and most people who are making the critiques of that case probably, if they had been on the jury, would have done a similar thing, right? Given the constrictions they were under, like you're saying, they had certain responsibilities and requirements, and they were interpreting the evidence that they were given. And it's not like they had the options that the public assumes they did.
Right. Although, have you sat on a jury before?
No, thank goodness.
You? Yeah.
I feel like I'm jinxing it talking about it out loud.
Oh, sorry. Well, it's awesome, actually. I thought it was jurors, to me, they remind me of voters. Like, they tend to reach the right conclusion for all the wrong reasons. And I think I don't know what your case was, but there was, they ask you all these questions, right? In this case involved soft tissue here, right? The brachial plexus, solar plexus, something like that. And so very explicitly, none of you have ever had an injury there, blah, blah, blah. No one in your family, nobody. The doors close behind us and this guy says, well, you know, my wife had an injury here on her brachial plexus. Let me tell you, Sonny. And it was like, but we reached what seemed to be a fair conclusion. So I don't know. I guess I'm saying the same thing you are, which is that, you know, that jurors tend to do the right thing. And it's an amazing process to see a disparate group of people sort of stuck in a room and forced to make a decision like that.
Take it very seriously. And I know in the voir dire, when they ask questions, you know, they ask you questions that you really might not have thought about at length before. There's a certain amount of self-scrutiny there. You have to really get into your feelings. You sort of expose yourself in a way. You sort of have to defend your logic to yourself to see if you're being rational and logical why you do or don't support the death penalty.
Jury selection or a shrink?
No, this is both. One case, I didn't sit on the jury, but it was a case involving a shooting here in suburban Sacramento. It was drug-related. So one of the questions was about the death penalty. Do I support or oppose the death penalty? Another question was about drug crimes. How do I feel about incarceration for people who are convicted of drug offenses? I mean, you're actually getting asked in an open forum with 30, 40, 50 people in a voir dire panel about your sort of your innermost convictions. And it's kind of a serious thing. And when you get in this other case that I actually served on, was a reckless driving case. But actually going behind closed doors and deciding an issue that met somebody's freedom for a period of time, or fines, financial impact, disturbs his family. I mean, you all have to sort of wrestle with this. And
there were financial issues here. Somebody was going to be out a lot of money, yes, depending upon what our decision was. And it was interesting to see people approach the solution to that, very little of which was contained in the instructions to them. Why don't we just split it in half, you know?
Why was there a six-person jury?
I was puzzled by that, too.
I was, frankly.
Yeah. It just seems odd that there'd be six people. I know in civil cases you can have fewer than 12 California.
Right.
And maybe, is that a state-by-state thing where it doesn't have to be 12? But it just seemed odd to me that, you know, we were talking about the judges, though. I'm really torn on this one. I really like the idea of appointed judges who are insulated and not part of the fray, you know, the political fray. I like that. And so that means an appointment, and sometimes for life. And I know there's some horrible judges that have been appointed for life you can't get away from. Yeah. But what I don't like are judges forced to run, I think it's every 6 years now, is it?
Forced. I thought it was 12, but go on. Yeah.
I mean,
the Supremes are 12. Superior Court may be less.
And basically having to run, actually having to campaign, there's just something odd about that. Have the same problem with regulators, like an insurance regulator. There's a good argument that they should be elected and popularly accountable, but then the cases, the companies they regulate, because of the campaign cash dimension of that, I got a problem with that. And
well, channeling my inner California Chamber of Commerce, having judges be elected was a job creator because it created a whole cottage industry of campaign firms. And you would send them X, some amount of money. Joe Sorrell used to do this. And you, the judge, would send them an X amount of dollars, and they would solve your campaign problem for you. Right? They'd, you know, pay whatever you had to pay and do some kind of mail thing if that was necessary, and it was done. So
Works for me. There was a judge, federal judge, now retired, here in Sacramento. And I was at a case that I was covering a trial over there, and a reporter with me, there was a break, and we got up to leave, and he forgot his briefcase on one of the benches there.
The reporter or the judge?
The reporter. So we were getting up to leave, and the judge said, hey, wait, you forgot your briefcase. Pick that up. There are crooks in here. And I thought, if the judge says that, then he must be right.
The lawyers all laughed.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, I think some of these rulings about what the state's prison system has to do to constitute humane treatment of convicted felons, I mean, not to channel my inner conservative Republican, but I mean, it seems a bit much where some of the health care that they mandate is better than millions of Californians can avail themselves of on the natural. And that all stems from an appointed for life federal judge who you can't do anything about, backed up by, you know, an appeals bench of judges who, if you pick the right triumvirate, you know, you get the stamp of approval. Anyway,
you know, that issue.
Enough about me. Let's talk more about what you guys think about me.
That issue, though, health care for inmates is actually coming up now at the county level. As we go to affordable health care, the question that the counties are having, because there's a dispute.
Because push there from realignment.
Exactly. Yeah, right. Exactly. There's a dispute over funding and who gets what. And the counties want to make sure that the inmates, they get money for covering inmates who go to, you know, to get transferred. So it's actually a big issue now.
Can we talk more about the informed electorate?
Let's.
Okay. You were bored with my lecture series on the state judiciary? So, given what you've just described, what's the general perception by voters of where California is? Are we going the right way? Are we going to hell in a bucket, you know? Or,
yes.
Or is it like we're okay, like we're coming out of the recession? I sort of think that external issues like the economy have a lot to do with people's mood, but.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. It's been kind of interesting because, like, one of the questions we asked on this survey, and it was done in May, so it's, you know, a few months ago now, but we asked a question about if the state's budget has improved this year, and only 17% thought it had, even though objectively it has. So I think there's a lag in sort of our interpretations of it. You know, that I think it'll take a couple of years of good budgets and budgets coming in on time and being balanced and having more money for people to adjust their impressions of what's going on. And if you look at, like, PPIC had a poll, it was also May.
I saw this one.
Yeah, and the wrong track sort of, you know, hope for the state questions were still pretty negative. But it's turning the corner. If you look at Field Series, too, people's impressions of how the state's economy is doing were, you know, incredibly negative for the last, like, since 2008, and have started to improve, although it's something like 72% still think it's, you know, pretty ugly out there.
Well, what touches Californians? My sister is the assistant librarian at Arcadia High School in the Arcadia Unified School District. So, like, once you get past school district level, there's nothing but bad people because they're making decisions that make life more difficult at the Arcadia Unified School District.
Yeah.
And just as an example, before the internet, when I was at the Chronicle, we would gauge what issues, you know, readers were interested in by who would go to the trouble of, in those days, getting out the big old fat yellow pages and looking to find our office number. And we arbitrarily set lunch as the cutoff date. But who bothered to call us about a story that had run that day on whatever the subject was? And it was basically childcare, right? Kids, nursing homes, right? Because people's folks are there. Cars, guns, and it's the Bay Area, right? So trumping everything was like animals, you know, like pet issues. Like you could have a bill that did nothing, right? It said, well, we should start to commence to begin to get ready to maybe treat little critters better in scientific experiments. Oh, God bless you, Mr. Lucas, for this important story, you know. But, I mean, in your research, it's stuff that actually gets into your house, right, that affects your life. Is it? I mean, that was our sort of really, you know, crayon-like judgment. But
yeah, I mean, when you ask people what, you know, there are different kind of poll questions that people ask that get at this. And you ask, you know, what are the top issues facing the country kinds of questions, for example, and those are asked nationwide on lots of different polls. And what you find is that it tracks with whatever the media is covering. So there's kind of a chicken and egg question there, and studies show that it's actually more media driven than the other way around, that we tend to think the most important issues are whatever the agenda tends to be in the headlines.
It's interesting. That's I would have thought the exact opposite.
Around
yeah,
from
exactly.
Your point of view.
Right.
Some of it's driven by actual events, right? Yeah. You know, so if the 9/11, obviously, that's what we think is the most important thing. But less of it is driven by, you know, my personal experience than you might think. But then when it comes to voting decisions, so those questions don't necessarily ask the strength of your opinion on those issues. They just ask which you think are the biggest questions, right? Before the country. So what do you think are the most important issues facing the country? So if, for me, it's the little animal thing, I probably won't list that in that survey, right? Because I know that that's not what everyone else considers to be the most important question. So it's not necessarily tapping what I think for me.
It has to look bigger and more important.
Right, yeah, okay, right. But then for me personally, the thing I care about when I read the paper, I might go straight to the bunny stories, right? And so there's a disconnect between how we measure those things on different levels. And so we do see people expressing more concern about stuff that hits them personally or that they can understand. So the other thing that political scientists will look at is sort of easy issues versus hard issues. And so the ones that people tend to want to engage in are the ones that you don't have to do a lot of research, that you don't have to have a background in already. So
absolutely,
something like a bond measure, I don't know.
Same for the reporters, believe me.
Right, yeah, right?
Truly.
So if it's something, you know, I'm going to know about the potholes in my street or about if I work at a school district, what's going on there, but not necessarily something that's more obscure. And that makes it hard when we're talking about something like healthcare reform or foreign policy or, you know, all sorts of issues that are objectively important but really hard to get engaged with.
I think communications trumps reality a lot. Mm-hmm. And the perception of something and the reality of something, the perception can be more important. In fact, often is. And so, you know, voters or people you survey being driven maybe not by events so much as what the media is covering that day, sometimes, not certainly not all the time, but many times what they're covering might be as a result of a pitch made by a communication specialist, or maybe somebody who's pointed out something that may be of interest to, you know, a major segment of the economy. It could be environmental, or, you know, insurance, or it could be petroleum, whatever it is. And so you get locked onto that. Or maybe it's a hunger strike in a prison that doesn't seem like it's all that big a deal, and yet it gets a lot of coverage. And so that becomes a big deal by the fact that it got a lot of coverage. And maybe it was a big deal, but there's a chicken and egg aspect here between communications and what gets covered, you know? And sometimes they're real events. Obviously, the Supreme Court deciding something on Prop 8, for example, that's huge, and that's coverage. But, and yet, the responses to that often are driven by communication spin. So I guess what I'm saying is there's lots of spin out there.
There's lots of spin out there.
Well, it made me wonder, okay, so there's a high crime rate in Stockton. I mean, does that sort of become a self-fulfilling prophecy? Like, you the news producer, it's like, all right, there's crime in Stockton.
I told you so.
Well, right. We should go out and cover that because there's crime in Stockton. And so the perception is that there's all crime all the time in Stockton, right? Because you're seeing that on the news because the self-fulfilling prophecy is being replicated over and over again.
And I think sometimes you cover that because the readers have that self-fulfilling prophecy, and, you know, they'll read that. And some people go to
publications. Told you they had crime there.
Yeah, I told you. Yeah, right. And they validate opinions. I mean, we kind of all do that. And so you're comfortable reading, especially true, I think, with, you know, in political commentary, for example. You're especially comfortable going to someone or an entity that validates opinions you hold, and it's replicated in a very balanced, nuanced, articulate way, and you say, I knew that all along, because we both agree. Doing the contrary takes a little more... is a little harder sometimes.
And then you adapt that new point of view that you agreed with and the details and assume that you already believe that you already knew these things before. And there's this really interesting psychological research that shows that people let's say that you are listening to a news outlet, they present new information to you that you didn't know, but it does resonate with what you already believe.
And then it reinforces your preconceived.
It reinforces it, which feels really
prejudices.
We
yeah.
love that, right? It feels really good.
It rocks my world.
Right, yeah. But maybe it's shifted you a little. You know, it's given you new information or a little bit of a new perspective. Then, in retrospect, you say that you always had that perspective,
right,
that you already knew that thing, because we don't attribute it to the source.
Well, that's interesting.
We attribute it to our own ideas.
So your perception is widened without you knowing it.
Yeah, well, that's the good way to think of it, I guess, right, yeah.
That's interesting. So does the internet, social media, the ability to put your fingers on, you know, an infinite amount of information create a more informed electorate?
I
there's the potential, right?
Yeah, I wish it did more than the reality. I mean, the problem that we have today, and I see this with my students all the time, is that there's just so much out there. It's, you know, I mean, there's that old drinking out of a fire hose thing. You know, it's not just that there's too much, though. It's that there's too much that you can't necessarily trust. And it's really difficult, especially for young people, but really for everybody, to figure out, you know, where is a quality source? Should I believe this account more than that account? Where would I get information that I can trust, basically? That's
okay.
The
so problem. Wouldn't that create a market for established news medium or media insofar as you know that if you go to the Baltimore Sun or the New York Times, that isn't just some knucklehead
right.
blogging this thing, right? I mean, but I don't get the sense that there's that perception out there that somehow, you know, going here, you get an elevated caliber of information,
right?
As opposed to, you know.
Which you do.
Lucas, I vent therefore I am's website, right?
Hey, look out for that one, yeah. You do get better quality information there. I mean, the problem with something like the New York Times is that, you know, there's this perception that it's, a couple things. One is that it's not approachable because they use, you know,
big words and stuff.
Yeah, and long stories.
Well, aren't they liberals, like kind of?
Well, and there's that idea too, which isn't objectively the case. I mean, their editorial page, but not their news reporting. But it's tainted with that as well, right? And so a lot of conservatives won't read it for that reason.
So people go on the internet to reinforce their pre-existing prejudices.
A lot of people do. Yeah.
And there's a lot of great reporting on the internet, and many of the best sites are newspaper sites.
Like Capital Weekly,
although we don't have a newspaper anymore, although our fingers are crossed, we hope to have some publication soon. I put that little plug in for a magazine. But the reporters...
It's probably better if I do it rather than you.
Right. Yeah, there's probably a conflict there. But the reporters have worked at print or have been trained... you know, who sort of came up the old-fashioned way, sound like a cliche, but they're used to writing a lot in short space. They've had editors who demanded that they cut. They had these heavily factoidal stories, sometimes to the point they look like telephone books, but facts and attribution and good reporting rigor. And so if you put that on the internet, it's basically the same, it is the same story, but the fact that it's in a different medium for some people takes away from it. As we get further and further away from newspapers and in other kinds of, I think, print, magazine, newsletters, but to other things, I think that'll become more accepted. I think it already is. And there's some great sites out there that I never see their print edition. I read The Economist now. I fell in love with The Economist and I never see the magazine because it's $7 a copy or something.
It's pricey.
But on the web, basically most of that's there. For simply signing up, and something like that, and their reporters,
which is a great
business
model, by the way.
I think
that's
it is.
To me, I think hyperlinks are cool, and something that you couldn't do cannot do in a hard copy newspaper.
Right. Yeah.
Where if you wish to read President Obama's State of the State speech, you can click right
Absolutely.
Here and get it if you want to, right? And it's kind of, you know, a highfalutin footnote, basically, right?
Right.
You know.
But it's available.
Right.
Yeah. And it would be cool if we could do that for things like speeches and debates with fact-checking, you know, if you could do it quickly enough, which is the problem, and you can't do it live on the spot. But if you could have the fact-checking hyperlinked into the text or even the visuals where it could somehow pop up or something.
It's still pretty amazing.
Pretty
like
cool.
You go to Governor Brown's press conference, and by the end of it, you know, he's shown off, you know, his ability to quote Latin. And he's left out an article or something because, you know, he majored in it in 1961, right? But by the time you walk out the door, someone in his press office says, well, you know, secretly what the governor meant to say was anno tranquilla tucti, you know, but he left out the tucti. Anyway, it's last call. So last question, what are you reading right now? What's on your nightstand?
I knew you'd ask this question, so I actually prepared for it.
Put something on your nightstand?
I put something on the nightstand, but I actually read it.
Took off the Marvel comic and put a book on the nightstand.
Havana Nocturne, which was recommended to me by... it's absolutely spectacular. It's the story of organized crime getting into Havana in the late 40s and 1950s up until the point where Castro takes over. It's the Batista era in Havana and the casinos that were built with mob money. It's really a lot of fun to read. I heard about it from Sandy Harrison, a mutual friend of ours. Okay. He told me, you got to read this, and it
was
great.
Well, that almost went out into the garage after our remodel, Havana Nocturne. It's been on my shelf for a long time.
It's a good read. And two things about it I thought were
the author
especially,
right.
One thing was, it's basically a biography of Meyer Lansky. So I don't know how many biographies of Meyer Lansky are out there, but this is really quite well done. And the second thing is there's a...
Is that who Bugsy Siegel worked with?
I think so, yeah. And there's reference to Las Vegas casinos being very upset with the people in Havana and putting them on a blacklist, the gaming commission in Nevada, not wanting them to participate in Las Vegas casinos. And you'd think, well, maybe that's because they were worried about mob connections. In fact, they viewed Havana as competition. Las Vegas did in the 50s.
It's like the existing Indian casinos view new casinos.
Exactly. Yeah. So anyway, it's a good read.
Kimberly.
I always have a bunch of political science on my nightstand, which is kind of depressing. Right?
Just for show, right? I mean, you don't really read that.
And I have quite a stack of things to get through. So I'm going to go with two things, if I may. One is this really interesting book by one of my new colleagues, David Barker, who's at the Institute for Social Research. He's a political scientist as well. And he wrote this book called Representing Red and Blue with a co-author. And they argue that Democrats and Republicans want a different form of representation than from each other. So there's this, in political science, there's traditionally the delegate and the trustee models of representation. So the delegate is, you know, listening very closely to exactly what the constituents want and what the district desires and follows public opinion closely. And the trustee, on the other hand, follows their own inner sense of what ought to be done and is less closely attuned to what people want day to day. And the argument in this book is that liberals want the delegate and conservatives want the trustee. So, you know, conservatives will respect, like, somebody who says they stick to their guns and vote on principle.
Interesting.
You know, so something like gun control, where, you know, background checks didn't get approved, but even though there's this huge public opinion in favor of it, if you were a conservative who favored this trustee model, you'd say, that's great, because, you know, those representatives stuck to their guns, literally. And then the other piece is Wild by Cheryl Strayed. I know it's been a bestseller for a long time, but I finally got around to reading it.
Lives up to the title?
Yeah, I mean, it's about her hike on the Pacific Crest Trail that, you know, goes just above us here and along Lake Tahoe, but all the way from Mexico to Canada. And, yeah, it's her backpacking trip. And it's well-written. It's very engaging. And I also... I did work like that when I was that. She and I are almost the same age, and this is, you know, years back when that she's talking about when she did this trip. And I worked in the wilderness for the Forest Service and did, you know, lots of backpacking kind of work too. And so one of the big thoughts I had the whole time is, why didn't I write this book? Why didn't I take notes and write a book like this? But it's good that somebody did.
Thank you both. This was terrific. You can watch this conversation or any of the other great ones we've had here at Politics on Tap at capitalweekly.net, calchannel.com. We're on YouTube. And until we sit down together again, remember, drink and think responsibly.
Capital Weekly's Politics on Tap is supported by a grant from the Tribal Alliance of Sovereign Indian Nations.